So here's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about DC statehood, and here's our agenda for tonight. So we're going to start with frequently asked questions, and I want to say something about questions. So as we reach out to our friends and fellow citizens around town and around the country, you're going to get lots of questions. And some of them will be thrown at you very dismissively. Others will be shockingly naive or uninformed or even misinformed. So it's going to be our job to treat every question respectfully and answer it to the best of our ability. We also get to say, I don't have the answer for you. So I'll have to get back to you. And then you get their connection, the way to get back to them and come back and talk to me. So one of the things that I urge us to remember is that every person who gets up the courage to ask a question, for every single one of them, there are at least a dozen other people in the audience who are interested in our answer. So this is why we're starting with frequently asked questions. We've also found it very useful to give people a short history of DC's establishment and governance to bring people up to date. Then we can talk about where things stand now and outline ways for people to help. So I'd like to suggest that you all have some paper and pen for the next part so you can make some notes for yourself. And if you have a question, please put it in the chat and we'll take them up during the Q&A. So here's where we're going to start. It's like, why statehood? That's one of the questions that we often get is like, why are you guys after this? So I just want you to take just a minute here and think, how would you answer that question? I mean, don't worry, I'm going to put up some answers that I've thought of, but I want to give you a chance to think about it. Because often people wonder why we're so bent out of shape. I mean, after all, we live in the nation's capital. It's a beautiful place, lots of power. I remember talking to someone long ago, who mentioned that I had a lot of power since I lived in DC. And it was a shock to her to hear that she, who lived in California, had much more power than I did. And indeed, her congressional delegation had power over DC's laws and budgets without needing to take my wants and needs into account. So let's talk about why statehood. What would we say in response to this question? And if you want to put your answers in the chat, you're welcome to. But let's just say why I say this. So we want to be equal with US citizens who live in the 50 states. We want the liberty to govern ourselves. We are not looking for any special treatment. And without statehood, we remain subjects of Congress, which is, one of those things. It's like taxation without representation. Do we remember that phrase? Okay. So anybody have any thoughts about this? Put it in the chat right now because I would like to move through this and then we can talk some more. So here's the next question. I don't live in DC. Why should I care? Well, we've heard this question expressed in many ways. This is just a local issue over there in DC. How would it matter to my state? So let's talk about the effects of having 700,000 people with no voice or vote in the Senate and only a voice in the House. Again, how would you answer this question? So here's how I do it. I ask about issues they care about. And I point out that having two senators and a voting congressman could make a difference to their issue, like climate change or gun laws or who gets on the Supreme Court. Furthermore, DC is often used as a petri dish for programs that aren't necessarily popular in their state, but eventually they'd like to see if they could move it on. Then, of course, our international reputation suffers because this is human rights violations, and people who run autocratic regimes elsewhere get to say, well, but look at how you treat DC, Why should we listen to you about democracy? And then, of course, fairness and equality actually matter in a democracy, I think. All right. Is making DC a state constitutional? Again, please stop and think for a minute. Does this kind of stump you? Because these are the kinds of things that you people say, well, I'm for DC statehood, and then they get hit with a question, and you're like, ugh, well, So often this concept is stated as a question, not as a question, but as a fact, as in the Constitution says DC is a federal district, so it's unconstitutional to make it a state. So I sometimes use that construction like yes, and response. So agreeing with the speaker that we can't make the whole of a DC estate, of DC a state, and that is not what we're doing. So no, we can't make DC a state if we're talking about the whole of DC, and that's often what opponents do, is they just say, well, you can't make DC a state. Well, actually, that's not what we're asking for. We can do this because the federal district, the capital, is still there. It's just smaller. And because Congress has already reduced the size of the federal district before the Civil War, and they sent the Virginia side back to Virginia. And then, of course, the Constitution says the federal district shall be no more than 10 miles square. So we're not doing anything unconstitutional when we want the 700,000 people to be able to live in a state. All right. Ready for the next question? Here we go. Oh, it's a map. It's so important to show people a map. Seeing how it would look gives people a better idea of what the plan is. I can't tell you how many times I've talked and talked about somebody, and then I've showed them the map, and you can see the ding, the light bulb go on. So we can also talk about the eighth grade trips to our nation's capital and point out that the kids really don't visit our neighborhoods and houses, but stay in the area of the Capital District. By the way, the new state would be Washington Douglas Commonwealth, and the new federal district would be called the Capital. But here's another interesting map. This is a map of the 131 neighborhoods in DC. These are often defined by historical events or cultural designations and have many overlapping boundaries with official ward lines that are subject to redistricting every 10 years and are the basis of electing council members to the DC Council. For instance, I live in Northeast DC in a neighborhood called Brookland because it was originally the site of the Colonel Brooks plantation that got developed in the 1800s, the late 1800s. So we're including this to help folks understand that real people live in real communities in Washington, D.C. And that's a fact that's hard to remember when there's so much emphasis on the national government activities that take place on Capitol Hill. So here's another question. Why not just go back to Maryland? So again, take a minute and think, how would you respond to this? Well, people who are concerned about adding two voting senators and a voting representative to Congress often ask, why don't we just go back to Maryland? Sometimes they even ask, why not go back to Virginia? So this is where we get to talk about retrocession and the fact that the Virginia side has already gone back to Virginia in 1846 before the Civil War. And we get to point out that those people living on the Virginia side of DC, they voted to go back to Virginia, and Virginia voted to take them back. So, you know, Maryland isn't interested in having us go back to them. So state boundaries can't be changed without the consent of the state. So Maryland has voted not to take DC back. And by the way, if you care, DC residents have voted to apply for statehood. They haven't voted to go back to Maryland. So it's one of those that, shall we pay attention to how things are working? So what about the 23rd Amendment? 23rd Amendment to the U.S. Constitution gave the citizens who live in D.C. the right to vote for president with three electoral votes. That was in 1964. That was the first time I was in D.C. So when the new state is admitted to the Union, the smaller capital district would still retain the three electoral votes allotted to it by the amendment. However, the amendment also states that Congress will be in charge of managing the use of the 23rd Amendment. So the new state would now be functioning like any other state with its own electors, having nothing to do with the 23rd Amendment. And the people who live in the Capitol would have the power to vote for president. They would have still have their three electoral votes, but there are no licensed residential facilities in the Capitol District, except for those that live in the White House. The Washington, D.C. Douglas Commonwealth Admissions Act has provisions for an expedited joint resolution to repeal the 23rd Amendment. And Congress does not have to appoint electors to the Capitol either. The 23rd Amendment can become inactive until it is fully repealed. So that often has people confused. I hope I've made some kind of dent in that one, but we'll see. Okay. So here's the next one. Isn't DC too small to be a state? Again, think about how you would answer that. So the first 13 colonies were dramatically different in size, and the founding fathers created a bicameral legislature, the House and the Senate, with a compromise that allowed every state, no matter its size, to have two senators. So the size question has been settled. In fact, land and acreage does not vote. People do. So there's Vermont, Wyoming, Alaska, North Dakota, South Dakota, Delaware. They're all under 1 million people. And Rhode Island and Montana are just over 1 million. See? So we have more population than two states, Vermont and Wyoming. We're on par with six. And I think this is really important. Let's talk about the way that kids learn about states. You know, those jigsaw puzzles that have pictures of produce that states provide. You know, for instance, Texas probably has a longhorn cow. Wisconsin has cheese. Douglas Commonwealth would be an urban state. So no matter what, it's going to be strange and new to a lot of people. And I think that's really important to understand. You know, I mean, I remember somebody in Iowa said, "That little scrap of land, that can't be a state." And then, of course, there are all those people on the hill who've said, "But you don't have any bowling alleys. And where are the cows? And what about, how about, you know, can you, are there any car dealerships?" You know, it's like, okay, what I think they're dealing with is the fact that they're having trouble picturing an urban state. And I think that would be really important for us to pay attention to. So, can DC afford to be a state? Again, think about that, because, you know, there are people who think that we still get, you know, are supported by the federal government. Well, let's look at the financial history. For many years, DC was promised a federal payment to cover all the various ways that DC was prevented from collecting revenue. So a recent study done of the federal payment history showed that although funds were regularly promised, they were often not delivered at the level they were promised. That made it hard to budget in a fiscal year. Furthermore, once DC was granted limited home rule, Congress also saddled DC with an unfunded pension liability. All the DC workers had been federal workers before home rule, and DC was required to continue paying into their pension fund without any help from the federal government. So eventually, DC was effectively bankrupt. And Congress installed a control board in the 1990s. The control board reset the budget, fixed the pension fund issue, and DC has been fiscally solvent with a good bond rating since then. So here's some more little facts. You know, we paid more taxes than 21 states in 2019. We pay more federal taxes per capita than 12 states. In fact, DC is a donor entity, and if we were a state, we would become a donor state. So, just to be clear, federal funds like Medicaid, TANF, roads for transportation, et cetera, make up about 25% of DC's budget. The rest of DC's budget is raised locally. So, there would be a major change, because we'd be taking back the judicial system. And that would be a, you know, a solid set of funds that we'd have to come up with. But there are many different ideas for how to make that happen. So, you know, and yeah, most states actually do their own thing. So would we. All right, let's go to law. What has the Supreme Court said? So we're often asked why we haven't received relief from voter suppression through the courts, particularly under the equal protection under the law provisions. No, and several cases have been tried and they've reached the Supreme Court. They've made it clear that they will not help. We've tried due process, we've filed equal protection, we've tried First Amendment. But in 2000, the Supreme Court ruled that DC status is a political one. And I want to just make sure that we have this. This is a direct quote. "Like our predecessors, we're not blind to the inequity of the situation plaintiffs seek to change. They get it that we are being discriminated against and we're being suppressed. But long-standing judicial precedent, as well as the Constitution's text and history, persuade us that this court lacks authority to grant plaintiffs the relief they seek. If they are to obtain it, they must plead their cause in other venues." So that's sort of the final say on the from the Supreme Court. And that's why we have, I think, the whole movement to get our full rights has shifted to statehood. But what about international human rights law? Well, anybody know about international human rights? The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was enacted in 1948, and it became the foundation for international human rights law. In particular, Article 21 says everyone has the right to take part in the government of his country directly or through freely chosen representatives. We don't get to do that. It also says everyone has the right of equal access to public service in his country, meaning you get to, serve. And the will of the people shall be the basis of the authority of government. Well, okay. And this shall be expressed in periodic and genuine elections, which shall be by universal and equal suffrage and shall be held by secret vote or by equivalent free voting procedures. So about 30 years ago, advocates for full rights for DC residents made the rounds of human rights commissions presenting DC's case. They have all found that the USA is violating the human rights of residents of DC. So, yeah, we are not having our human rights respected. All right, so now we come to a very league-ish issue. So, how can the nonpartisan league support a partisan issue like this? And I hear that all the time because everything has been so polarized in this current situation, this current atmosphere and environment. Well, here we go. The League has not changed in its support for full rights since 1938. So we're just still saying we should have full rights. Statehood is a civil rights, human rights, racial justice issue that really shouldn't be partisan, regardless of how the parties are dividing themselves up these days. Disenfranchisement is not okay just because of how some people might vote. And then, for those who say, but you got to have a partner to come in, Well, Hawaii and Alaska were admitted together to balance party affiliation, and they have flipped. And I keep forgetting which one was which when, but I know that they used to be one way and now they're the other. And then the other thing that I say, because for Democrats, the people often say this is a Democratic power play. And, I'm like, really? Are you telling me, okay, I'm for sure at the first one around, the first round would probably be Democrat. But are you really telling me that our four ballot access parties in DC would just let the Democrats proceed? That there wouldn't be highly contested races for real voting seats in Congress? Really? I think I have more trust in how things would actually work if we actually had full rights. All right, so now we're going to go to some history. So let's just check here. When did DC lose congressional representation? And you've got four options. We never had it when Virginia's side went back to Virginia in 1801 or in 1789 when the Constitution was adopted. When do you think we lost congressional representation? This is just a start off. What do you think? Because we're going to turn our attention to DC's history. All right. 1801. That's when Congress moved in on us. And from one day to the next, we were just disenfranchised. So I'm going to now condense more than 200 years of history in a few sentences. So feel free to ask me more details if you feel you need them. So U.S. citizens, many of whom had fought in the Revolutionary War and living in D.C., were still able to vote in all Maryland and Virginia elections during the 10 years after D.C. had been established. When Congress moved into D.C. and passed the Organic Act of 1801, that immediately disenfranchised everyone in D.C. So the congressional record shows that even back then, they were concerned about turning, and this is a quote, DC citizens into subjects. So the idea that the founding fathers wanted it this way is not true. Many arrangements for local government were tried over the years as you look at this timeline here. There's, in 1847, it shrinks the size. In 1871, there's a territorial government. But no matter what, Congress continued to exercise total control over DC as described in the Constitution. And as I mentioned, they even reduced the size of the district when they sent the Virginia side back to Virginia. After the people on the Virginia side voted to retrocede, and Virginia voted to receive them. So this established a clear precedent that Congress is able to reduce the size of the district. So about this territorial government, when it became clear that there would be many African Americans elected in DC, among other reasons, Congress changed the arrangement to a presidentially appointed commission. That dictatorial arrangement lasted for nearly 100 years. So then in 1964, well, in 61, but the 23rd Amendment went into effect in 64, and it was passed that allowed DC citizens to vote for president. And then in 73, I mean, in the late 60s, President Johnson started the transition to a more locally based government, and Congress finally established this limited home rule government in 73. But just like in the 1870s, they can dissolve it at will. And by the way, this Congress has a bill in it that is calling for the repeal of home rule. It won't pass, but it's still there. So then, in 2016, we voted overwhelmingly to petition for statehood with a new constitution and boundaries. And then in 20 and 21, HR 51 passed the House and then passed again. And S 51 was introduced with a record number of original co-sponsors. So, as you can see from the very beginning, DC citizens called for full rights and full representation. This is a 222-year-old fight, and I guess it's now going on 223. So, our momentum towards statehood has been accelerating with 45, now it's 46 co-sponsors in the Senate, but we're now engaged in a struggle to protect home rule with opponents once again using DC to make political points. Our attempt to update our criminal procedures, some 10 years in the making, was overturned by Congress, leaving us again with one of the worst criminal codes in the country. And, as I mentioned, bills have to repeal home rule have been introduced. So there we are. So let's look at the current status. So, like I said, current Congress is attacking DC home rule. HR 51 has 206 co-sponsors, plus the main sponsor, Eleanor Holmes Norton. And S 51 has 46 co-sponsors, plus Senator Carper, who's 47. So Senator Carper is retiring this year, so we'll need a new sponsor in the Senate. and we'll need solid support from current co-sponsors in Congress and solid support from new members of Congress in 2025. So one of the ongoing struggles for DC residents is how often we have to spend time fighting off congressional interference. We have a sign-on letter objecting to the riders in the current appropriations bill that reach into and change our local decisions about many issues, both large and small. Standing alone, these issues would not get passed, but as part of the appropriations bill, unless they're deleted from the bill, they will pass because the appropriations bill is a must-pass bill to keep the government open. So please note the number of representatives and senators sponsoring, co-sponsoring these companion bills. We are so close to gaining statehood, and yet so far. This is not the time to stop, which is why we're looking forward to 2025 with a new Congress that may be more friendly to the passage of the Washington, D.C. Admissions Act. So here's where we can go to look at what you can do to help. So we now have a petition that individuals can sign. Please sign our petition on our website. You can just hit lwbdc.org and the front page will see sign statehood petition. You can ask your friends to sign too. You can talk to your friends, neighbors, relatives about DC statehood, because we know how many people don't know what needs to be really known about the disenfranchisement, the voter suppression that's going on. You can invite us to speak at a committee, a group, your neighbors. We have a team that can make small presentations and do lots of Q&As. We have an organizational resolution that we can provide you, a template. Get your organizations to adopt a resolution supporting statehood. Let your legislators know that you support DC statehood. And when you get stuck on a question thrown at you, let us know, because we keep on figuring out how to answer these various questions. So here's where to find more information. And I'm giving you the DC government's website too. If you have a specific question, you can write statehood@lwvdc.org. You'll get me. And if I don't know the question, I'll go research it and figure it out. And of course, you can also write me to schedule a briefing. So that is the end of my official, I can stop share. And back to see your lovely faces, and we can talk about this. So I think Yalyn, I don't know whether Yalyn or Anne were looking at the chat for any questions. And of course, we're a small enough group that we could also just, unmute and say, well, what about blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, Anne and I have been monitoring the chat, but we don't see any questions in the chat. So I encourage everyone to just ask their question if they have one.
I'm Sally Cassidy, and my first question is, how do I ask a question?
Here you are. You can ask a question just by saying it right here without having to be complicated, Sally.
Okay, well, I haven't absorbed enough. I'm actually was thinking of the technical. I took the medicine man had to show me, I don't know how to, I was tuned in, but all I had was, I don't know, a list of names of participants. I couldn't get you, but he got you for me.
Oh, good.
How to manage this Zoom page is my question.
Oh, I don't know about that one.
Okay.
So, Carol, let's go to you.
I'm gearing up to work on getting support from a national organization, Third Act, of which I'm a part, in addition to the league. And I'm thinking about, I feel some tension. I absolutely agree that we have to be ready in 2025 if we gain a trifecta of pro-democracy senators and representatives. Then that would be a great opportunity, and we have to be ready for that opportunity. But I'm trying to time my ask or demand of Third Act nationally and the 40 state affinity state groups of Third Act to sign the resolution. But I'm thinking, like, I was going to start with California and get in touch with them, also with the league in California. But you know, they just had their primary, and there was so much information out there. I just felt that, well, I think we should wait till the primary's over at least. And so I'm ready to start these things, but I know my own inbox, my own brain is so overtaxed with the election coming up that I'm just wondering how we can capture the attention for this very related thing. It's about, we're trying to preserve our democracy this year. That's it. That's what's at stake, and our climate. But everybody's thinking about the elections. So if anyone has any idea of how to inspire excitement about DC statehood in other states, right now, I'm happy to listen.
Oh, thanks, Carol, for that very knotty Knotty question. It feels to me like one of those things that we are constantly working with. You know, there are always things that seem like more important than DC statehood. So that's one of those pieces that I think is just part of our endemic to our issue. What I do think is, like, if you go back and you go to that slide where I said, well, what about, you know, what, why should I care? That the reality is that if there had been two senators, a congressman, congresswoman who would have been able to actually vote, well, what would the votes, those close votes, look like? What would they have looked like if we had been able to vote? We have 700,000 people sitting on the sidelines. That is what's true. And, you know, letting us loose might actually help things they really care about. So that's part of how I come at it. But you're right, the primaries are overwhelming us, and I think we may just have to just keep talking about it. Let me go to Jeannie
So
Adams.
actually, sorry, if I may, and I want to add on to this, and I'm also wondering if other folks have answers to this, because this is a very important question. So what I tell people is, and I think we've, you know, if you care about climate, if you care about common sense gun control, if you care about voting rights, if you care about healthcare access, if you care about women's rights, then you would want two senators and a voting representative from DC, because DC cares about all those things, and we are very forward-leaning on all of those, right? We have some of the most accessible voting systems in the country. We are very strong on gun control. So any organization that wants national movement on these issues should really want two senators and a congressperson from DC. And if we're talking about protecting democracy, nothing is as good as protecting democracy as expanding it to 700,000 of us who don't have it, right? So that's what I've been working on, because I do think you have to make clear that it's in their interest in a strong way. And maybe contact your states after their primaries, because then there's this lull, right? There's going to be a lull.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
For about
anyway,
a day.
I don't know if anyone else has any thoughts particularly on this, but.
Good. Yes. The floor is open. All right. Let me go to Jeannie.
Oh, hi. So what I was thinking about when I saw the DC courts on your list is, how do you convince a powerful bloc like the DC courts that they would be better off under DC government? You know, they're so used to congressional funding and that kind of stable support when there's not a shutdown that's about to happen. But so I started to think about that a bit. And I know that what Congress took them over back in the 1990s. I used to work for the courts, so I'm used to doing these congressional budgets and submitting them to Congress and, you know, used to all of that and that consistent funding source that the court has. And I think they've gotten used to it. And so we have a lot of, you know, judges there and, you know, some pretty powerful folks. So I was just wondering if the league has given any thought to how we might convince them to support this as well. If in fact, I mean, I don't know that they don't, but when I saw it come up on your slide, it just caused me to think a little bit more about it.
Well, I'll give you one piece. One of the things I know is that that the courts are badly understaffed, and there are tons of and I'm sorry, I don't have the actual numbers. That might be, the last I heard was something like 53, but don't quote me. anyway, we're down a number of judges, and that's because all our judges have to be nominated by the president and confirmed by Senate.
Yes.
And if we were a state, we could manage that differently. We could manage it better, maybe better, I don't know, but at least it would be people who were interested and concerned about our issues rather than whatever it is that they're on the Hill are worried about, which is not about how DC is running. So that's one piece. I also know that we had a panel about the judiciary on one of our Zoom things last year. And was a very interesting panel, because part of what people were talking about was like, well, if we were able to be looking at and be running our own court system, then you know, there might be some very different philosophies that we would be running, and I don't know whether that would help the courts feel better about it, but they might, you know, because it would be a different sense of how things work in DC. Anybody else have something you want to say about that?
I just put in the chat, there was an interesting piece in the Post, the paper today, but online earlier probably, from a former prosecutor, federal prosecutor who worked in DC, and talks about how the DC courts not being answerable to the residents of DC and having different bosses. So it is in all the crime discussions that have been going on in the city, people keep mentioning the fractured nature of our criminal justice system, right? Because the juveniles are, you know, under our attorney general, but then the adults are under
the U.S. attorney, yeah.
Right, U.S. attorney, you know better than I do. So, but anyway, so I do think it's actually one of those issues too that highlights this problem we have with this weird jurisdictional structure we have.
Very true, yes.
Yep. All right, Sherry Templeton. Hello.
Hi there. I'm interested in what it actually means to be ready in 2025. Do these do these legislations that are currently fairly well supported, HR 51 and S 51, don't they expire at the end of 24? And who are the current heavy hitters or, you know, really strong sponsors that may or may not still be in existence when that occurs? And who might we start working with, or, you know, just informing that this background information is happening? This is a strong effort that's happening. And, you know, to kind of get their buy-in for bringing it forward again. And then the second little issue is, what's your timing on wanting, for instance, Colorado's 17 leagues resolutions to be submitted to you all? What timing are we looking at?
First of all, I'm a little unclear, but I know there's going to be some serious turnover in both the House and the Senate. And in particular for us, we have Senator Carper, who's been the lead sponsor for our S51 for years now, will be retiring. So we're at this point looking for our new lead sponsor in the Senate. And it's not clear to us how that will all work out. And from Noah, he's saying the new Senate, U.S. Senate sponsor should not be someone who voted to repeal our criminal justice. Yes, exactly. You want to say more about that, Noah?
Oh, sure. I'm in no way the expert on the old criminal code, but there's about a dozen U.S. senators, I think it was 14 at the time, that voted to uphold our limited home rule. And, from both parties, a majority of both parties voted to overturn our autonomy. So I think the new Senate sponsor should be one of those 14. And after the election, probably it's going to be 10 or 12 that are left at this point to sponsor the statehood resolution, because statehood and home rule go hand in hand.
Thank you. Yeah.
Could just to interrupt there, could Carper pass the baton? Could he give us some suggestions on who's a good target?
I'm sure that discussion is going on. I know that Eleanor Holmes Norton's office is working on this, but I don't have the details, since obviously these are often sort of back chat kinds of discussions.
The only thing I'll say about Senator Carper is I was able to be in the Senate chamber when they took the vote, and Senator Carper didn't vote on this measure despite being in the chamber. So it was a little hard to see the sponsor of our statehood resolution. He didn't vote against us, but he didn't vote for us while he was there. So that's another thing to keep in mind with him.
Yeah. You know, we have to remember that all of these senators are always balancing what they are having to deal with in their home state. And then the question becomes, you know, why bother about, you know, sticking their neck out for DC when that could get them into trouble in the state? Yes, all politics is local, said Catherine Ray. And yes, Higher Angels is an important piece. And also, you know, our previous comment that, you know, sometimes it might be helpful to have a couple of extra votes on your side in the House and the Senate. So yeah. Okay. Do we have other questions or comments? I think
Anne.
Another Anne.
Sorry, another Anne. I'm afraid of mangling your name, Anne. I'm sorry. But there she is. Our amazing naturalization ceremony coordinator. But her question is, and it's a good one, who are the persons and organizations actively opposed to DC statehood?
Mm-hmm. Well, I can. Oops. Hello.
I'm sorry. I hit something and I don't know why.
Actually, we're.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Sorry about that. Okay. No idea where that came from.
Yeah. Let me just say that it is extremely political. So the people who are up against us are basically, I would say, Republicans, because they are calling it the Democratic power grab. They would be happy to go out of, they wouldn't mind going out of their way to somehow make us seem worse, seem down. Oh my God, you know, look at all the crime. I mean, they're doing that to us all the time. And so when they keep doing that, then the issue is really, you know, how do we even talk about statehood when we seem like we're just drowning in all of these difficult problems? Yes, the Washington Post is not our friend either. There's a lot of people out there I think they find it convenient to trash DC because we can't do anything about it. There's, you know, what are we supposed to do? We can't vote them out, you know? And so it's really difficult. The real question, I think, is, and having, I mean, we've now traveled to, when we could travel before the pandemic, we had traveled to more than 30 states, and I'll mention that, and Hong Kong, and talked about DC statehood and the level of ignorance really was astonishing. I mean, we were talking to mostly League people, and League people are often quite interested in all kinds of issues. And yet, I mean, I had people asking me, I'm a member of the Washington DC League, and they were asking me, do you really live in DC? You know, I was like, yeah, you know? And I mean, really, it was very difficult to keep a straight face sometimes. But Carol is bringing up another question, which is like, can we fold DC statehood into the John Lewis Act? I don't think so. I mean, let me just say blankly, the John Lewis Act is sort of itself, and trying to add it in would just add even more controversy, as they call it. But what I think is really important is that we really need to think about DC statehood as part of the voter suppression issue in the country. No, and so I would really like us to, every single time that we hear or see somebody talking about, well, we have to fight for democracy, we have to defend democracy, we have to have full rights where everybody gets to vote. And then we say, yeah, and that's got to include Washington, D.C. No, it's like the way that the D.C. League of Women Voters called itself the, you know, voteless League of Women Voters when we first were established in 1920, no, because even then we were not allowed to vote. Even though every other woman in the country was allowed to vote, we weren't, you know, and the 19th Amendment had passed and it didn't apply. So these are the kinds of questions that I think we need to just keep bringing people back to. It's like, well, how, what, wait a minute. Why is it that we can't vote? Why is it that we don't have a representative? Why is it that your congressman can come to DC and decide on a law that affects me? What is that about? How is this American? You know, is this, you know, how about taxation without representation? What are those kinds of things? And I think that those are the things that I've seen people, you know, really go, huh, oh, and while they afterwards, they may not, it may not stick for very long if we keep bringing it back up again and back up again and back up again and include it as, you know, like when you go to, when you're on your social media and there's something that says, we got to fight voter suppression. You can answer, you can say, yes, hashtag DC statehood. No, you can, I do that about 50 times a day. So those kinds of things I think really make a difference one way or the other. So any other comments?
So actually, if I can add to that too, because I was out there with it was a whole coalition of folks who were protesting in front of the White House in 2020, 2021 to get Biden to force the Senate to even have a hearing on the voting rights bills back then. And at that time, it was DC statehood was part of a group of three. It was the Freedom to Vote Act, the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, and DC statehood. So it has been in the past. I mean, in the discussion, I agree with Anne. I don't think it would get rolled into the bill because, you know, it's a standalone admission act, just like other states came in, you know, other states came into the union with these admission acts, basically. But I do think we need to get it back in the conversation. So wherever you are, if you get contacted by these groups and they say, you know, donate money because we have to fight voter suppression, you should say, Anne, where are you on DC statehood? You know, because that is voter suppression. That is a voting rights issue. Groups will always say they agree with that. We just need to get them putting it back into the conversation too. There's a chat discussion about we should talk about which Republicans were supported statehood. It's true, there are a couple. Barbara Garlock has some great quotes from a couple of Republicans. So I don't know if those were, like, I don't know if Nixon holds any sway over current Republicans, but it does show that it has not always been a Democratic issue, right? It's been an issue. Different people across the aisle have identified it as a problem over time.
Well, in fact, the first statehood bill that was put into, you know, entered into Congress, why can't I remember this, was put in by a Republican and a Democrat, Ron Dellums from California and Fred Schwingel from Iowa. So, you know, it was a bipartisan bill. And so, you know, it's not necessarily true. I feel like singing, you know, it ain't necessarily. Never.
All right, before we get into statehood karaoke, though, so Anne again has a, Angie, actually, where's Angie? Okay, Angie has a question. What she was asked and didn't have an answer for was, what would happen if a sitting president decides to vote in the federal district? I believe there are provisions in the bill to counter that, but honestly, I don't have a good answer to that. And I don't even know, where does the current sitting president vote?
Well, the current sitting president usually votes in whatever their home state was in, you know, like if they came from Delaware, they, you know, vote there.
In Delaware, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. But in order for a presidential vote to count, you have to have electors. I mean, when we vote for president, we're actually voting for electors. So whoever is, like, you know, so then the number of people who vote Democrat get they have the three electors that we have be Democrat electors. If we were Republican, we'd have three Republican electors. But Congress has to, is the one, is it's the entity that manages the electors in the federal district. So if they don't identify, if they don't appoint electors, nobody can vote and have anything go forward because there are no electors to carry it, to carry that vote to the Electoral College. So that's why, you know, the DC Admission Act talks about Congress would do this, and there's an expedited way to have the 23rd Amendment be voted down, be repealed. Noah, do you want to add anything to that?
I guess, yeah, I would agree with everything that Anne said. You know, the amendment itself has two sections, the second part saying that Congress has the right to enforce the amendment by appropriate legislation. So they could just say, we're not administering an election. Or if that's not constitutional for whatever reason, they could change the rules where, like other states are doing, the winner of DC's three Electoral College votes could automatically go to whoever won the national popular vote or the Electoral College winner without DC. Therefore, it wouldn't, you know, it wouldn't change the outcome of the election as a whole while still technically having those electors being counted.
Yeah, I think what people forget is that most of this isn't written in stone, and we can solve problems, right? We can change kind of what's been done by convention. We can, I mean, so yeah, anyway, I just find that interesting as if people think, oh, well, this is the way it is. It can, you know, this is going to be a problem. I sometimes also think people are finding reasons to say no to statehood. And I also want to address in our last couple minutes, I've had people say, oh, but there's so much federal property in DC, oh, or there are embassies in DC. And I said, well, you know, they're consulates in Houston, in Texas, right? They're consulates. There are foreign, you know, there's property owned by foreign governments across the United States. DC would not be alone in this. And there are states that have like if you look at Nevada and Utah, they're like 90% federal land. I mean, we know the federal government knows how to negotiate with states. It knows how to work with states. There are agencies, and I've also heard, oh, then DC would have too much control over the access of important parts of the government. I'm like, well, the Pentagon's in Virginia. No one's worried about Virginia blocking access to the Pentagon. I mean, you know, like all of these things that people sort of come up with. I'm like, these are all solvable. The federal government has a presence in every single state, some with larger presence in some, you know, in lots of states. So it's fascinating to me. I just think people, like, it's just, they, you get these sort of responses that you're like, well, let's just think about this. I mean, I often ask a question back. I'm like, oh, so, you know, doesn't your state have a lot of federal land? How does that work? You know. So anyway, those are the things I've run into.
Yep, absolutely. Catherine.
I think a big part of this is exactly what Anne, since we have so many, Anne, our moderator, mentioned when someone said, do you actually live in DC? Because I get that question when I was younger, and people would look at me, and the second follow-up was, well, you don't send them to public school, do you? Actually, yes, I do. And let's look at where the school shootings usually are. It's not the urban schools. It's the suburban schools with lots of money and parents who, anyway. But what we really need to do is to show people that there are people like Noah, and there are people like every Anne on this call, and like Sally and me, who live here, and we're just normal people. And I don't work for the government, and my husband didn't work for the government. We do the same sorts of things that people in other places do. I'm a librarian. There are librarians in every state. So I think that's one of the things that we can do is get out and show people that we're not all lobbyists. And when I gave a presentation at the University of Scranton a number of years ago about not statehood, but DC voting rights, several of the students said, but they're all the people who actually live in DC are just all lobbyists and they all work for the government. And actually, more government employees live in Virginia by sheer number in Maryland than live in DC. And we just have to educate people that. And then the other one, of course, is have a really good reason for why don't you just move?
Right.
And what I tell people is, do you really want your nation's capital to be a ghost town?
Yeah.
Because that's what it would be if everybody just moved.
Yeah.
I sometimes say, well, you know, there are people who have lived here for generations and whose families came here to escape slavery. So I think, you know, asking them to move is, I don't know how to say, pretty good. I have to find a better, I mean, I don't want to, I kind of leave it at there, like, without saying you're being really rude or presumptuous or just like, well, you know, but anyway, but the reasons people came to DC too, right? Like, anyway, so.
Yeah. Well, thank you, everybody. It's 8 o'clock. I'm going to honor, even though I couldn't honor the beginning, I'm going to honor the end. And thank you so much for a really good discussion and for hanging in with us. And we will be in touch.